prevalent in the whole world, including India. The biggest factor for corruption, for biggest factor for human rights violation in my mind is corruption. Corruption that makes people mad for power and money. Climate, we have seen during the first wave of the pandemic, the entire nation was seized with this horrific scenario, the horrific image and the imageries of migrant laborers. But that was not because of climate, but for commerce. Climate, which leads to displacement, widespread displacement, migrations, forced migrations. Commerce, which leads to inequality, poverty, and therefore many other symptoms that are seen in the society. Conflicts, the world is rife with conflicts here and there. We in India also have quite a few pockets, which leads to violence and therefore rampant human rights violations. These factors have been there for not just a millennium, but perhaps millennia. Humankind is as old as violations of human rights, some might argue. Well, it is not enough for all of us to just think about the factors, but we should also remember on these occasions the guidelines which have been there for all of us to follow. And the guidelines have been very, very clear. Professor Kumar mentioned that it's a very complex issue today. But in my mind, the complexity is basically our own making. Human life has always been simple. And human guidelines, human life guidelines, have similarly been very, very simple. Who doesn't know the three maxims of all having right to life, liberty, and security? That there should never be any slavery or servitude. Or there should be right to freedom of thought, conscience, and religion. And what more do we want? I think these three simple maxims could have made this world a much better place. But then we also know that in the name of development, in the name of so-called civilization, we have inflicted on all of us, our own selves, the gaps that has put chasms, has put gaps in the society, the narrow domestic walls that we have created for the world, for the people in the world, the knowledge gap, the capacity gap, the commitment gap, or the security gap. And these gaps, as long as they are there, human rights violations will keep occurring on the bosom of Mother Earth. Let me end with a saying from none other than the former Secretary General of the United Nations, Mr. Kofi Annan. He says that we all know what the problems are, and we all know what we have promised to achieve. What is needed now is not mere declarations or promises, but action to fulfill the promises already made. And my dear colleagues, my dear students, these gaps are actually the impediments to effective implementations of human rights in the world. Over to Mr. Datta, but before that, I'm sure our colleague is going to introduce Mr. Datta. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. Once again, a hearty welcome to all of you, most importantly to Mr. Datta, IPS. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for your insightful observations. And I beg your pardon on behalf of the School of Law and Justice for some of the noise that were disturbing you while you were deliberating on an important topic such as human rights. And you had rightly mentioned about the three maxims. And to end with, you had also referred to Kofi Annan's remarks that we need to actually embark on actions to fulfill the declarations and the testaments that are already existing on human rights, including international human rights. Thank you so much, Professor Dr. Navin Das, for your insightful observations. Now, I would take the privilege of introducing Sri Rupa Kumar Datta, Indian Police Service Officer of the 1981 batch. He is a BTech from IIT Kanpur and an MBA from Swinburne University, Melbourne. And he served as the SP, the Superintendent of Police, Karwar, DIG, Belgaon, and the IG, Gulbarga. He has also served at the SP CBI, New Delhi, and he was there as the DIG Delhi Region and the Joint Director CBI Delhi Zone. He has also worked as the Additional Director General of Police, Karnataka Lokayuto, where he was selected by the Honorable Justice Santosh Hegde, former judge of the Supreme Court, and then Lokayuto. Apart from that, he has also served as the Additional Director General of Police, Law and Order, Karnataka State, and Director General of Police, CID, Special Units and Economic Offences in Bangalore, till June 2012. In June 2012, he went to the CBI as the Additional Director CBI and was promoted as the Special Director CBI, and was, in fact, the second senior most officer in the Central Bureau of Investigation, one of the premier investigation agencies that we have in India. He was appointed as the DG and the IG of Karnataka State on 31st January 2017. And after his superannuation, after post-retirement, he was selected as a member of the Karnataka State Human Rights Commission. And he was also the recipient of quite a few honors, including the President's Police Medal for Meritorious Service and the President's Police Medal for Distinguished Services. He also had the experience of working with the UK police, and he stayed in Yorkshire for a while as a part of the investigation team. And last but not the least, he attended quite a few meetings which were organized by the World Bank. And he was also the Asian Ombudsman for Association. He was also the. He attended a conference held in Bangkok, which was known as the Asian Ombudsman Association Conference. I beg your pardon, because this was not known to me. So some part was known to me, some part was not known to me. And without much ado to his, because he is an order in himself. So without much ado, I would request him to take the floor, and the floor is yours, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Professor Rajat Banerjee, foremost Professor Dr. Navin Das, Vice Chancellor, Adams University, Professor Santosh Kumar, Professor and Dean, School of Liberal Arts and Cultural Studies, Professor Dr. Chitrapu Kamaraju, all the staff of Adams University, and dear students of Adams University. It's a pleasure to be part of the university today to talk about the human rights. Professor Navin Das has taken me to a pedestal where I feel nervous in saying something, because he made me one of the most famous police officer of the country. I am a very simple officer and a simple human being. Whatever the achievements or whatever the positions that I have held has been through my only hard work. And at the moment, yes, being part of the State Human Rights Commission, I am experiencing the angle of human rights, which is rather an antithesis of the work that the police does. In fact, if you ask anyone, they will only ask how a police officer is sitting as a member of the Human Rights Commission, because they are the biggest violators of human rights. But nevertheless, the government chose me that I should be part of the human rights, and I'm seeing the violations that the police do in terms of violation of human rights sitting in the Human Rights Commission now. I mean, which perhaps so much of attention I didn't have at the point of time when I was in the service. Having said that, first of all, let me say that, last 1.5 years now, we have been in the midst of a peculiar phenomena. We all know that is the COVID and the impact of COVID that we have all been facing. And this particular webinar is also as a part of that we are now used to. I mean, at one point of time, we used to be physically present in conferences, seminars, and now it has become a habit of us to be part of webinar in holding whether it is conference or whether it is seminars or any other lectures. And of course, I've been seeing Professor Das, mentioning about people to keep mute, and I think we are still to get used to holding a webinar. I mean, these are certain, initial problems which I think we have to get used to. Now, the impact of course the COVID that we have seen, I am not going to talk about that, because that is something which is a phenomena once in a century. And I am also not going to have heard about that people have mentioned about Afghanistan. Right now, the Afghanistan is occupying the mind world over. We are still, of course, wait and watch policy we are seeing as to how the Taliban, the present version of the Taliban, govern the country, but in terms of the apprehensions of the people, yes, it is well founded, because we have seen the original version, the first version of the Taliban, as to how the human rights violations have happened at that point of time, and therefore everybody is waiting with bated breath to see how the things are going to unfold in near future. Now, I would like to, while talking about, before I speak about human rights, I would like to just mention some of the very important features of the international scenario. If you see, I'm going to take you to a particular report which came in Frontline magazine, and there is a statement of Julian Assange, who is the founder of the WikiLeaks. And if you see what he has said, about the current world, he said that the world is not sliding, but galloping into a new transnational dystopia. This development has not been properly recognized outside of national security circles. It has been hidden by secrecy, complexity, and scale. The internet, our greatest tool of emancipation, has been transformed into the most dangerous facilitator of totalitarianism we have ever seen. Now, this sums up where we are and where we are moving. I would like to take you to the headline news today, where Honorable Supreme Court had directed asked the Solicitor General of the country that to submit affidavit on the on the biggest issue. But once again, the affidavit has not been submitted, as you are seeing the headline news of the covered in all media, and they have said that we would like that an expert's inquiry be set up. I'm not going to comment on all this aspect as to, because the matter is sub judice in the Supreme Court. But I'll further read from the magazine itself on the issue of how the private space is getting squeezed of the people. Our greatest apprehension at the moment is this only. The magazine mentions, at that time, many people might have written off Assange's statement as hyperbole. But as things stand today, with technological advancement firmly establishing digital authoritarianism, now the words used, phrase used is digital authoritarianism across the world, his words have proven to be prophetic. You are all aware of that there is a particular bill which is at present pending in the before a select committee of the parliament. This is the protection of personal data bill. Now, since 2019, when it was introduced, it is before the select committee of the parliament. Today, we are under captivity of these digital authoritarian. You ask, each and everything of ours is known, and they are rather guiding us towards as to how we move on. So the way the world is operating is only through it is a digital world, but only through the directions that this particular, all the digital authoritarians, they are wanting us to move. That is one aspect which is very disturbing. Second aspect which is there, which is a corollary of that, one can say, is the surveillance state, which I just spoke about, that Pegasus. Now, it is not Pegasus itself. There are several such apps and several such measures by which all kinds of surveillance which is happening, whether it is in the form of the various instruments which are being, or whether in person, which is called techint and human. So whether through human being or whether through technical things. So it has become a surveillance state. I mean, it's not, I'm talking about any particular nation. I'm talking nation as such. Thing is that, as Julian Assange has said, this is a tendency towards moving towards totalitarianism. I'm not going to talk about any country as such. It's not proper for me to talk about it, but whosoever is wanting to establish himself or herself is wanting to establish in a full authoritarian way. And democracy rather seems superficial. You know, if you see in such countries, the way the things are happening. So that being the case, of course, it's natural that there will be an increased surveillance which happens, and the people will be chased through various means. And things are things comes to the rock bottom when we hear about even people planting things into the systems of people, the opposition or those who oppose, in order to get them prosecuted. Things have come to even that, to that extent. So this is something which is very worrying. So, sum and substance is that privacy is getting eroded. And that is what is something which is, which we have to be really concerned about. And at the moment, there is something which is, us versus them, which is going on, everywhere, whether it is us or not, or whether it is them. So that kind of a feeling is on the rise. And if you see in the social media, now social media, of course, if you see that way, could have been a boon, but it is more than a boon, it is becoming a bane. And we are seeing that we talk about today machine learning, we talk about artificial intelligence, but if you see this machine learning and artificial intelligence, how it is actually turning out to be a bane when it comes to social media. You see this, in fact, I have been watching myself, you know, I mean, if I want to watch particular kind of videos, then I find that the machine learning and the artificial intelligence always take me to those things which I like. And this is happening with every person. Every person, this is happening that a particular person, whatever he likes, whether it is or again, he will be fed by the social media through the medium of artificial intelligence, only such videos which is to his liking. And because of that, a person, he gets further poisoned of his own viewpoint. He's not able to accommodate others' viewpoint. And this is what is happening increasingly at the moment. You know, therefore, that is that us versus them phenomena is on the rise. So this is as youngsters, I'm talking about the students of the university. Please be aware, you know, this thing is on the rise. You know, you have to be, as I let me go back to what Professor Naveen Das mentioned, you know, human lives have always been simple. He said human lives have been always been simple. And in the name of the civilization, it is of our creation. In fact, rightly he said that, because it is we only who are, you know, constantly putting in all kinds of isms, whether it is any ism, whether it is communism, this ism, that ism, whatever isms, it is we who have brought in. And the worst part is we are not ready to accommodate others' views. I was very happy to see a particular news item in media yesterday, where Mr. Shashi Tharoor, he actually, who is the MP from Thiruvananthapuram, he has actually opposed the, you know, the his party this thing, you know, the party what it wants, that the syllabus in a particular university in Kerala, where they have introduced two particular persons' works in the syllabus of the university. Well, they may be called as rightists, not of the thought which has been so far prevailing. But then he said that what is wrong in accommodating and understanding such people, and also he says that why not we consider their views and then argue out as to the fallacy of their views or why their views are incorrect. So this is how the debate is always like that. You know, it is not that just, you know, us versus them. We will not tolerate others' views. So this is one of the greatest problem that the humanity is facing now. Of course, this us versus them is also leading to, which someone has touched, that is the minority bashing, which is happening everywhere. Now, someone said about Rohingyas, you know, whether it is Rohingyas in Burma, whether it is Tamils in Sri Lanka, whether it is Uyghurs in China, whether it is the Hindu Sikhs in Afghanistan, whether it is Hindus who are being persecuted in Pakistan, everywhere. I mean, I'm talking about the neighborhood, but it is happening all over the world, including America, where there are people who are being persecuted, particularly minorities are being persecuted, and I mean, which I call as minority bashing. So this is the kind of world where we are at the moment. And this particular increasingly, which is called polarized world, and the us versus them phenomena is something which we have to take note of, and we have to actually see human rights from that perspective. Now let me come to the human rights. What is it as such? Per se, human rights, if you ask about the concept of human rights are inherent rights. You know, by being I'll just put on the this the slides that you can have a look at. Human rights are inherent rights which accrue to every person by virtue of his or her birth as human being. By being born as a human being, the rights which accrue to you are called human rights. Very, very simple. And which Professor Das also had mentioned that the basic human rights, if you see, is the life, liberty, equality, and dignity. These are the basic rights, right? Being born as a human being, nobody can take your life, nobody can take your liberty. You are equal being born as a human being, and nobody can take your dignity. You know, your dignity has to be there. These are the basic human rights which are accepted. Then next. The other thing is that they belong to all persons, irrespective of any distinction based on sex, race, caste, religion, and the like. That means, irrespective of whatever denomination a person may be, they belong to every person without any distinction. They are, that means, universal in character. And they are legally protected also. These are the basic characteristics or concept of human rights. Next. Now, if you see human rights impose obligations. Why I'm saying it impose obligations, of action and omission on states and state actors, because human rights is something which has to be taken note of and taken care by the state as such, state per se, and the state actors. And I'll come to that later, that even the human rights commissions which have been set up are also looking into this aspect, whether the states and the state actors are taking care of human rights or not. Next. Now, if you see, obligations are of three kinds. Now, these are first to respect, second to protect, and third to fulfill human rights. If you ask what is respecting human rights is just not to interfere in the enjoyment of that. For example, if I observe a particular religion, if I follow a particular religion, or if I eat a particular food, or if I like to wear in a particular way, nobody should be, you know, talking about as to how I should be dressed, what food I should be eating, or what. Now, for example, what is happening in Afghanistan, you know, if you say that, no, we want it in this particular fashion, that is gross violation of human rights of violation of the human rights, not only of the people who are as such, but particularly the people who are not following the particular way they want, or not the followers. It's not following. It's not the followers of the particular way they want them to either eat or dress or observe religion, etc. Second is to protect. To protect is that by the state. For example, somebody violates your right. Obviously, what will you do is you'll go to the police station. Or you have to get the khata of your land done. Then you will go to the revenue official. And if these people are not attending to your whatever the grievance, then the state is not protecting. So obligations has to be in the form of protection also. Next. Then third is to fulfill. Fulfilling can be in two ways, either by facilitating or by directly providing. Facilitating is how? Like, state enables conditions so that people on their own, for example, your Adamus University itself, or for that matter, any other school, colleges, hospitals, you know, where state provide you land, state provide you with the in means where you can start your own, you know, school, college, university, hospitals, because there is a demand and people want that, and state is enabling you to do that, and state on its own cannot do so much. So that is facilitating means the state to engage proactively in activities that would strengthen people's ability to meet their own needs. And then providing is directly providing. That is, state is providing the form of say municipal schools or universities, colleges, government colleges, schools, universities, etc., or hospitals. This is directly provision. So these are the three ways, the three kinds of the obligations to for human rights. That is the obligations which impose which are imposed for protection of human rights. That is number one, to see that not to interfere. That is to respect the observation of the culture, traditions, etc. of the human being, to protect if there is a violation. And third is to fulfill the human rights of the people. Next. Now, let us also not forget that apart from state, human rights also impose obligation on each individual as such. Human rights basically cannot be observed if each individual do not follow the duty there that is imposed on them. Now, if you see if there is a red light on the street and in the street and you crosses that red light, you may hit some vehicle which is coming following the green light. So because you haven't followed the duty, you have violated the human right of someone else. So it is like that in every sphere. You know, if you observe your duty, you are respecting or you are enabling the rights of the other human being. Next. Now let me come to the evolution of the concept of human rights. In fact, human rights, if you ask that way, is not something which is a phenomena of the Middle Age or the modern age. You know, human rights has been there as old as the civilization. I think which Professor Naveen Das also had mentioned in his opening remarks. The very fact that we believed in the Vasudeva Kutumbukam is nothing but that we consider the entire humanity to be brotherhood. You know, that's nothing can be more than the observance of human rights if we consider everybody to be part of the family. So it is as old as that, and in various literature you will get the observance of human rights in ancient ages. But I am just coming to the Middle Age, where rather the modern age, I would say, where the phenomena of human rights were recognized, and these are in the form of where the American Declaration of Independence, where for the first time it was proclaimed that all men are created equal and endowed with inalienable rights of to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. In fact, a person called Thomas Paine, if you see, he had published a pamphlet called Common Sense, which supported America's independence from Britain. And his later work Rights of Man argued that people should overthrow the government if it abuses their rights. So this is when the human rights were being talked about during the American Declaration of Independence. And then the other thing is during the French Declaration of the Rights of Man during the French Revolution, there were a number of philosophers and activists like Voltaire, Rousseau, and Voltaire had highlighted the hardships and injustices suffered by many people around the world. And he wrote that for people to be truly free, they had to know and defend the basic rights of all human beings. Even Rousseau, the Swiss philosopher Jean-Jacques Rousseau, had proposed that government should only rule with the consent of the people. So this is where, you know, the idea of human rights were being recognized in the modern world, that it is the human rights which matter more in governance than anything else. Next. But post Second World War, as Professor Naveen Das had mentioned about what happened during the Hitler regime in Germany and the persecution of the minorities, including Jews, we all know that phenomenon world over, you know, that for the first time, people realize that what a tremendous amount of violation of human rights had happened. So it was immediately after that, the post-Second War, the first thing that came into the mind of initially before that there was League of Nations, but then this the United Nations, which was formed, it came out with a milestone document it is called, and it is called the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. That is on 10th December 1948, and United Nations General Assembly passed this and declared this Universal Declaration of Human Rights. And if you see these articles, I just quickly go through the articles, some of them. I'm not going through every article, but if you see that, you will understand the what are human rights and the importance of human rights. Article 1 mentions that all human beings are born free and equal in dignity and rights. Article 2 mentions everyone is entitled to all the rights without distinction. The same thing which we have been telling about the concept of human rights, that without distinction, the human rights are to be, you know, followed. Article 3 mentions everyone has right to life, liberty, and security of person. Next. Article 4 mentions no one shall be held in slavery. Article 5 mentions no one shall be subjected to torture. Article 7 mentions all are equal before the law and are entitled to equal protection of the law. Article 9 mentions no one shall be subjected to arbitrary arrest, detention, or exile. Article 11 mentions that everyone charged with a penal offense has the right to be presumed innocent until proved guilty according to law in a public trial. And no one shall be held guilty of any penal offense which did not constitute a penal offense at the time when it was committed, nor shall a heavier penalty be imposed than the one that was applicable at the time the penal offense was committed. I hope you understand this Article 11 too. You know, it says that you cannot retrospectively bring in any law to either hold anyone guilty or to give him enhanced punishment. Next. Article 12 mentions that no one shall be subjected to arbitrary interference with his privacy, which is of much debate at the moment. Then Article 13, freedom of movement. Article 15 recognizes right to nationality, right to a nationality. Everybody has a right to a nationality. And in this context, let me mention that, you know, which is so-called the CAA, which has come in, and then the, people being considered that they do not belong to the nation, our nation, then they have certainly a right to belong to a different nation. And that is what the Universal Declaration of Human Rights says, that everybody has a right to a nationality. You have to recognize that whichever the nationality he has needs to belong to a nation. Article 17, right to own property. Article 18, freedom of thought, conscience, and religion. Article 19, freedom of opinion and expression. Article 20, freedom of peaceful assembly and association. Next. Article 21, right to equal access to public service. Article 23, right to work. Article 25, right to a standard of living. And in this context, mother and childhood are entitled to special care. Article 26, right to education. Article 27, right freely to participate in the cultural life of the community. Now, the Universal Declaration, I'm not going through, I just mentioned the important, there are total 30 articles, but more or less I have narrated all the articles which are of significance and importance, which you should know. Next, let us come to the international covenants. You know, 1948, we have seen the declaration was made, but then subsequently, in 1966, two covenants came in. That is the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights and International Covenant on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights. Now, in 1966, these covenants came in the form of some kind of a contract, you know, between the nation states and the United Nations, that they would observe the human rights. And India is also a signatory to these covenants. And we have accepted and adopted the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, and we are also signatory to international covenants on both the covenants. Now, I'm not going into detail into the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, because they are basically pertaining to the civil and political rights and taken from the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. They are almost a repetition of the same. There are in all about 53 articles, and article, of course, 28 to 45, they relate to the UN Human Rights Committee. It's a body which is constituted at the United Nations level, where a nation can go against to that particular committee if there's a violation of human rights by any other nation or anybody can. In fact, not a nation, anybody can approach that human rights committee if the particular nation, you know, his rights are not being taken care of. So that is the one part of it. And out of the remaining articles, also they are more or less repeat of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, so far as the civil and political rights are concerned. But I am only touching upon one particular article, that is Article 4. Article 4 I am touching upon because in time of public emergency, it mentions that in times of public emergency which threatens the life of the nation and the existence of which is officially proclaimed, the state parties to the present covenant may take measures derogating from their obligations under the present covenant to the extent strictly required by the exigencies of the situation. So far, okay. Because it's like emergency where you may have to derogate from the particular covenant, you know, all the obligations which are mentioned, the covenant. But it mentions, provided that such measures are not inconsistent with their other obligations under international law, number one, and do not, which is most important, and do not involve discrimination solely on the ground of race, color, sex, language, religion, or that means it has to be indiscriminatory in nature. Then, one of the most important things which you should understand why I wanted to mention this particular article of the International Covenant is that, however, no derogation from Article 6, 7, 8, 11, 15, 16, and 18 may be made under this provision. It may be whatever the exigency. You cannot have any derogation from these articles. Now, let us see which are these articles. These are the articles like Article 6, which says that every human being has inherent right to life. Now, you know the famous case, the Jabalpur ADM, Jabalpur case, Justice Y.V. Chandrachud, as part of the majority in the infamous ADM Jabalpur case in 1976 during the emergency, endorsed the suspension of fundamental rights during the emergency. And this has been now turned upturned by Supreme Court, none else than by a bench consisting of Y.V. Chandrachud's son. And he has said that was a perhaps an error. That the fundamental, of course, it has been subsequently in several rulings, Keshav Bharti and all that, he said that there are something called the basic structure of constitution which cannot be, you know, done away with. But then, to that extent, things can go wrong. Therefore, it says that there cannot be any derogation from Article 6, which mentions that everyone has inherent right to life. Article 7 says that no one torture. Article 8, no one shall be held in slavery. Article 11 says no one shall be imprisoned merely on the grounds of inability to fulfill a contractual obligation. Next. Article 15, no one shall be held guilty of any criminal offense, which is a criminal offense at the time when it was committed. Then next. Article 16 says everyone shall have the right to recognition everywhere as a person before law, and Article 18, everyone shall have the right to freedom of thought, conscience, and religion. That means even during the time of emergency, exigency, also these rights are something from which one cannot derogate. I mean, these are to be, they are still existing. So this is what I wanted to mention so far as the International Covenant on Civil, Political, and Economic Rights are concerned, and civil and political rights are concerned. Now, let me come to the other covenant, which is the covenant on economic, social, and cultural rights. Now, I'll quickly go through a few of them. If you see this, the difference is that these mentions in terms of, these are called second generation rights. The first generation rights are the civil and political rights, and the second generation rights can be called these rights, you know, right to work, enjoyment and of just and favorable conditions of work, right of everyone to social security. Next, special protection should be accorded to mothers, children, and young persons should be protected from economic and social exploitation. Article 11 says adequate standard of living. Article 13 says right to education. 15 talks about right to take part in cultural life. Next, so this is so far. So these are the some of the main articles. So far there are total 31 articles, but I have mentioned some of the main this thing, if you see, these are the second generation rights. And these rights are called the economic, social and cultural rights. So these are recognized in the international covenant pertaining to these rights. Now, let me come to the human rights in India. Before that, next. Before I come to the human rights in India, and I just like to mention these may not be the challenges, emerging challenges. I'm not looking into the political and economic challenges in the country. I am only looking to the challenges which are which makes impact from the point of view of the human rights. Now again, the same phenomena is there in this country also, the phenomenon of intolerance. And the phenomenon of intolerance is, you can say that the last point I have mentioned is again been, you know, strengthened by the hatred caused through social media, and particularly the WhatsApp and other such means. And this the us versus them phenomena is very much happening here also. And not only that, as I mentioned, that people are being fed the bane of artificial intelligence and the machine learning. They are feeding people to their viewpoints only, and they are further, you know, this us versus them is getting spread. Then, of course, that is leading to some kind of, you know, we are seeing, of course, of late, we have not been hearing much, but we have heard enough, you know, of all kinds of, you know, unlawful attacks which are happening, including killings which have been happening all over the country, and including, of course, the state where you are located. We have been hearing things about from every corner of the country, things which are happening in terms of attacks and killings. And then, of course, connected with that is the suppression of the freedom of expression, which from time to time, although it has been accepted, we not only in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, even the International Covenants also, and we are signatory of that, but still that is happening. Today there are people who are behind because of, you know, they transgressed perhaps the which is mentioned in the Constitution of India, and that is why they are behind. Then the right protection of personal data bill that is pending, and we are at the moment facing a lot on this. In fact, there is a particular person, a former judge who had gone to the Supreme Court, and Justice K.S. Puttasamy, whose petition in the Supreme Court in 2017 has led to a landmark judgment that upheld the fundamental right to privacy under Article 21 of the Indian Constitution. And the Justice D.Y. Chandrachud, same I mentioned about Y.V. Chandrachud's son, Justice D.Y. Chandrachud, who as part of the 9-judge bench that delivered this verdict, said privacy is the constitutional core of human dignity. This is a recent judgment came out where he recognized that privacy is the constitutional core of human dignity. In the Puttasamy case, D.Y. Chandrachud, as part of a 9-judge bench, categorically said that the judgments rendered by all the 4 judges constituting the majority in the ADM Jabalpur case are seriously flawed. This is where he had said, you know, now it has been corrected, and he said that was seriously flawed, where you say that the fundamental rights don't exist. Right to life under that, right to privacy is also the constitutional core of it. So these are the things which we are now, you know, the phenomena which we are facing in terms of human rights aspects, if you see. And this is something which is worrying, and we have to now talk about that as to what this country provides. Now, I'll go straight to next one. I'll go straight to the Constitution of India. In fact, India's obligations to protect human rights are derived, among others, from 2 sources. First, they are values which are enshrined in the Constitution of India. And second, they are included in a number of international human rights conventions. As I mentioned, we are the signatory to the international covenants on both civil and political rights, as well as on economic, cultural, and social rights. So not only that, in various other conventions, which also talk about human rights, we are signatories. Next. Constitution of India was, in fact, if you see Constitution of India, 1950, in fact, 1949, this was in the making, and 1948, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights came to be. And therefore, it has been greatly inspired by the aspirational goals set out in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. And if you look at the Constitution of India, if you see that chapter 3, you will find not only chapter 3, even chapter 4, you know, part 3 and part 4, you will find that the all the articles mentioned in these both the parts are as if they are derived from the Universal Declaration of Human Rights only. Next, then the preamble of the Constitution, if you see the preamble of the Constitution, underlines the need to secure to all citizens justice, liberty, equality, and dignity. If you see, if you look into the preamble of the Constitution of India. Next. Then, apart from that, a number of civil and political rights, as I was mentioning, including right to equality, right to life, liberty, freedom of conscience, are mentioned in the part 3, that is the fundamental rights of the Constitution of India. And next. And a number of economic, social, and cultural rights are mentioned in the, like right to education, health, work, etc., are mentioned in the Constitution in the part, in part 4, that is directive principles of the state policy. Now, of course, one should know that directive principles, they are not possible in, but then Supreme Court had said categorically that directive principles are fundamental in the governance of the country. So a state should strive towards the fulfillment of the directive principles, though they are not enforceable in as such per se in the court. Now let me come to the Constitution of India. Now if you see, as I was mentioning, Constitution of India, next. Constitution of India, part 3, which are pertaining to the fundamental rights. See, the if you remember in Article 1 of the the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, it mentioned about equality before law. So the Article 14 also mentions about the Constitution of India states equality before law. And then Article 2 mentioned about the non-discriminatory nature. So it also, Article 15 mentions prohibits discrimination on grounds of religion, race, caste, sex, or place of birth, etc. So it directly inspired from the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. But one particular article, sub-article in Article 15, I would like to mention. Here is Article 15.4. And 15.4 mentions that, and in fact, it came out, this was one of the first amendments which happened. No sooner the Constitution of India came into being. And this mentions nothing in this article or in Clause 2 of the of Article 29 shall prevent the state from making any special provision for the advancement of any socially and educationally backward classes of citizens or for the scheduled caste and the scheduled tribe. So, though we mentioned, from the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, we say that it has to be non-discriminatory in nature, but then Article 15.4 mentions that nothing in this article will prevent from making special laws for the weaker sections of the society, the women and the children, the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe, those who have been relegated in the society in the past. Article 16 calls for, Article 16 calls for equality of opportunity in the matters of public employment. Public employment, please note this public word I am again saying, in the matters of public employment, it says that there cannot be any discrimination. So there has to be equality of opportunity. But then again, Article 16.4, if you see, it mentions that nothing in this article shall prevent the state from, in fact, this was there while the Constitution was in the mentioned that nothing in this article prevents taking any provision for the reservation of appointments or posts in favor of any backward class of citizens, which in the opinion of the state is not adequately represented in the services under the state. So therefore, the reservations which came in, of course, they came in through this Article 16.4 in the matters of public employment. And then there have been some more amendments which I'm not going into, like 16.4A, 4B, etc. And as you know, now at the, even in, for the purpose of even the matters of promotions also, there are reservations and all, just to ensure that the people who have been left behind can come up to a particular level. Article 16, although it calls for equal opportunity, it also talks about that for the weaker sections of the society, there has to be some kind of reservations. Article 17 and 18 calls for abolition of untouchability and titles. Next. Article 19 is a very important article. It mentions about rights to freedom under subsection 1A to G. Now, the various rights, if you look into freedom of, like, 1A mentions about the freedom of speech and expression, B mentions about to assemble peaceably and without arms, likewise to form associations or unions, to move freely throughout the territory of India, to reside and settle in any part of the territory of India, and to practice any profession or to carry on any occupation, trade or business. So these are the fundamental rights. It was a right to property, which has been subsequently taken away and put in the schedule so that it cannot be challenged also. I mean, because some properties may have to be, you cannot have absolute right to property. It has been taken away. But these are the rights which are there now in the rights to freedom. And if you see that these rights have already been mentioned in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, as well as in the covenants, both on civil and political rights, as well as economic, social and cultural rights. So those are the rights. But having said this, that these are the rights which a person has, there are certain conditions which are mentioned, and these are mentioned in Article 19, 2, 3, 4, 5, like that. And if you look into Article 19, 2, it mentions, it imposes certain reasonable restrictions on the exercise of the right to speech and expression. As I was mentioning while talking about speech and expression, in mentioning the emerging challenges in this country, you know, there are certain people who are behind bars. Perhaps they may have violated, as the law enforcing agencies must have felt, and as the court feels. Of course, most of the cases are sub judice at the moment, but that the reasonable restrictions on the exercise of rights may have been violated. And which are these reasonable restrictions? It mentions that rights conferred by the said subclause in the interest of the, now the restrictions on freedom of speech are restricted to the extent that if it affects the interest of the sovereignty and integrity of the country, that is of India, the security of the state, friendly relations with foreign states, public order, decency or morality. Now, these are the things, or in relation to contempt of court, defamation of incitement to an offense. So if these are violated, then to that extent, the freedom of speech and expression will be curtailed. Similarly, even to assemble peaceably and without arms also will be curtailed if it is again against the interest of the nation, integrity, sovereignty, whether it incites violence, etc., etc. Similarly, or to form association, unions, even to move freely. Now, to move freely throughout the territory and to reside anywhere. Now, these are again restricted by, because you must have seen that there are certain places where there are some inner line permits to be taken and you are restricted from going. Now, these are again imposed through reasonable restrictions, that is in for the protection of the interest of any scheduled right. For example, you know, if you have been to Andaman Nicobar Island, you know, those the Jarawas, earlier people used to go and they used to feed them, and there were problems which were happening, and now the government has imposed, the local administration has imposed that the restrictions on movement of people in the Jarawa area. This is indeed in terms of protection of the so-called scheduled tribes and other people living elsewhere. So to that extent, the restrictions can be brought in. And similarly, the restrictions can be brought in even to practice any profession or to carry on any occupation, trade or another. For example, if you require to get to say MBBS, you need to clear a particular examination. If you need to get into a particular say IIT or IIM or any other institution, you need to clear, but these are the in the form of reasonable restrictions or civil services. You have to go through a particular regime, or you have to have a particular kind of a degree. Now, you can say that I have absolute freedom to practice any profession. No, you cannot practice medicine without having particular, you know, some kind of a say degree. And so these are brought in the form of restrictions, and these are well understood. So Article 19, although mentions about right to freedom, which a person should have, but then subject to certain restrictions in order to see that the society orderliness is there. Society doesn't go into disorder. Next. Article 20. Article 20 is very important from the point of view of the law enforcement agencies. It says that protection in respect of conviction for offenses, and also for people, of course, the people as such should know that no person shall be convicted of any offense except for violation of a law in force at the time when it has been. I was mentioning that, you know, if you remember, if you recall, both in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights as well as International Covenants on Civil and Political Rights, I had mentioned two things, that you cannot be convicted of an offense, or you cannot be hauled for an offense, prosecuted for an offense, for which was not in existence at the point of time when the offense was committed. Second is that you also cannot be prosecuted and punished for the same for the offense with an enhanced punishment. So these are the two things which is mentioned in Article 21. No person shall be convicted of any offense except for violation of a law in force at the time of the commission of the act charged as an offense, nor be subjected to a penalty greater than that which might have been inflicted under the law in force at the time when the time of the commission of the offense. Then Article 22 mentions no person shall be prosecuted and punished for the same offense more than once. Once you have been prosecuted and punished, after that you cannot be again hauled up. No, he was not punished to the extent he should have been punished. I will again hold the prosecution and punish him more. All that you cannot do. No person shall be accused of any offense. No person accused of any offense shall be compelled to be a witness against himself. This is very important. Article 23 mentions that an accused has a right to silence. You cannot be compelled to be a witness against yourself. Next. Article 21 is one of the most important articles. You know, it mentions about right to life, and it mentions that no person shall be deprived of his life or personal liberty except according to procedure established by law. This is more important, this phrase, except according to procedure established by law. That means, people, like, for example, people are being even sent to gallows, or people are being incarcerated in jail. How it is done is, it is according to procedure established by law. So anybody and everybody has an absolute freedom to life and personal liberty, but according to a procedure established by law, if in case you are violating your own personal freedom, like I had mentioned, those restrictions which are imposed. If you commit an offense, obviously you have violated the freedom which have been granted to you in the Constitution, and therefore according to procedure, again, you cannot be just arbitrarily taken to the gallows or to the or in the jail. It has to be according to procedure established by law in a fair trial, and it has to be open. Article 21A was introduced subsequently, and it mentions rights to education. Article 21 says free and compulsory education to all children of the age of 16 to 14 as determined by the state. Next. Article 22, again, from the point of view of law and order, protection against arrest and detention in certain cases. It says that no person who is arrested shall be detained in custody without being informed as soon as may be of the grounds for such arrest, nor shall he be denied the right to consult and to be defended by a legal practitioner of his choice. So he has to be informed of the grounds for arrest, and he cannot be just arbitrarily taken into custody. And then he has a right to be defended by a legal practitioner. Next. And two mentions that Article 22, two mentions that he has to be produced before the nearest magistrate within 24 hours. Of course, excluding the journey time if he is being brought from a distant place. Next. 23 and 24 mentions about the right against exploitation, such as forced labor, child labor, etc. A number of laws have been brought in to enforce these rights. And Article 25 to 28 mentions about the right to freedom of religion. Now, in this, of course, Article 25 to 28, if you see in the freedom of religion, it has mentioned that Article 28, if you see that nothing in this article, though it is freedom of conscience and free profession, practice and propagation of religion, this article mentions Article 25. But then it mentions in Article 25 too that nothing in this article shall affect the operation of any existing law or prevent the state from making any other law. For example, in recently that case where Sabrimala, you know, that providing for that throwing open of the Hindu religious institutions of a public character to all classes and sections of the society. So it has happened not there only, several places, you know, where people were being restricted and now they it has been thrown open. That is in view of Article 25, sub 2. And similarly, Article 26 and 27 and 28, if you see, it also mentions about that Article 26 mentions that every religious denomination can maintain institutions, can establish and maintain religious institutions of their denomination. And then Article 27 mentions that no person can be taxed. Like earlier, you know, jizya tax and etc. you must have read about in medieval India. And today, no person can tax you for a particular religion. So Article 27 says no person shall be compelled to pay any taxes, the proceeds of which are specially appropriated in payment of expenses for the promotion or maintenance of any particular religion or religious denomination. And Article 28 mentions that no religious instruction shall be provided in any educational institution wholly maintained out of the state funds. So if out of state funds it is mentioned, then there should not be any religious education being given there. Then Article 29 to 30, these are basically cultural and education rights protecting particularly the interests of the minority. And Article 29 and 30, that if you see, speaks about cultural education rights. In that, important is right of minorities to have the right to establish and administer educational institutions of their choice. This is what is mentioned in the Article 30. That is how the minorities, you know, they establish their own universities, institutions, and all that. And that right has been provided under Article 30. And the next and the last important article, which I would like to mention, is the Article 32. This is basically a right by which you can enforce all other rights. So this is basically remedy for, these mentions remedies for enforcement of rights conferred in Part 3. Next. These are in the form of writ petitions, which you can file. You can file writ petitions in Supreme Court under Article 32 or under 226 in the High Court. Next, the article, the Part 4 of the Constitution mentioning, these are what are contained in the covenants on economic, social, and cultural rights. And these same things are incorporated in the directive principles of the state policy. These are same thing which I'll just quickly go through. The citizens, men and women, equally have the right to an adequate means of livelihood, which I had mentioned. Then equal justice and free legal aid. Next. Right to work, education, public assistance, certain cases, just and human conditions of work, living wage, etc. for workers, early childhood care and education to children below the age of 6 years, promotion of education, and like in our Ganatan Wadi, I don't know, similar things, you know, where to 6 years, the people are given free education and taken care of their early childhood care who can't afford. Promotion of educational and economic interest of scheduled caste, scheduled tribes, and other weaker sections. Duty of the state to raise the level of nutrition and standard of living. There are a number of such programs where, particularly the people who can't afford, the lactating mothers or the mothers who are in the family, where they are provided a certain level of nutrition, etc. And even post delivery also, they are provided all kinds of help. Next. So these are the things which are mentioned in the key principles. Now, apart from that, the Parliament has further enacted various legislations which seek to protect and promote the rights of the vulnerable sections. I mean, I need not go through it. You know, there are a number of such this which are whether on women and children, you know, act when on the women. Apart from what is mentioned, there are the acts which are to prevent domestic violence, so many, in the what Professor Naveen Das was mentioning on the sex trade, you know, to prevent that, and the forced labor, on that also there are child labor, there are a number of acts created. Then the has come out with then the protection of the human rights. This is very recent, you know, the protection of human rights came in 1990, the country force human rights to have kind of a person can go and complain. And that is how came the protection of human rights, which mentions about formation of National Human Rights Commission and the State Human Rights Commission. And it also talks about human rights courts. Now, as I am a member of the State Human Rights Commission, there is a State Human Rights Commission in West Bengal also, and there is a National Human Rights Commission in Delhi. So these State Human Rights Commissions, they have a particular procedure. A person can file a complaint. You don't have to get a lawyer, or you don't have to file in the form of an affidavit, or it is as simple as that, a plain paper and application with your name, address, and your contact number, if it is there, if it is given, and if you find that it is fulfilling the, if it mentions about violation of human rights. Now, as I was mentioning earlier, you know, we look into in the protection of human rights. If you see, it mentions that the section 12 of the protection of human rights, it mentions that if the state actors, you know, the state and the state actors, they fail to fulfill the or fail to protect the human rights, then we step in. For example, if a person goes to a police station and he is not taken care of, as I was mentioning in the beginning of my talk, that a number of violations we have found have been happening. And in fact, if you see that way, in our commission also, I don't know about other commissions, I'm sure that that must be the case elsewhere also. I can say safely that about 40% of the cases pertain to the human rights violation happening, which are against complaints which are coming against police, I mean human rights violation by police, and these are in the form of illegal detention, then police resorting to physical and mental violence, police being abusive and using vulgar words, non-registration of complaints, the cognizable offense being not taken as a cognizable offense, then in the matter of enforcement of traffic regulations also high-handedness happens. And a number of things, you know, the interference in civil matters, property disputes, etc., on behalf of a particular person, and violating our human rights, improper investigation, delay in investigation. So there is no end to, you know, the kinds of violations which are happening, and we are getting such kinds of complaints. So a person can come and give a complaint that the state is failing, the police having failed to protect the human rights. If they come, then we call for a report, or we do our inquiry. We have got an inquiry wing which does the inquiry, and if they find that human rights have been violated by a particular state actor, then the law provides that under Section 18, we impose a certain we recommend certain action. Now, this can be in the form of registration of a case. It can be a criminal case against the particular violator, or it can be in the form of payment of compensation by the violator, or it can be even departmental action. I would just like to take you to a recent judgment which I don't know whether you have had a chance to look into. It came out in yesterday's media. It mentions that High Court jails sub inspector for illegal arrest. Cop found violating Supreme Court guidelines. Now, Telangana High Court has sentenced a police sub-inspector to 4 weeks imprisonment for arresting a person without issuing any notice under Section 41A of the Criminal Procedure Code. As you know that in 2006, the CRPC was amended, and they brought in, apart from Section 41 was there, but 41, they have brought in 41A, B, C, D, like that. And under 41A, one has to issue notice. The Supreme Court has held that in all cases where the arrest of a person is not required under Section 41.1 CRPC, Section 41.1 of the CRPC mentions as to when a person can be arrested without warrant. So, required under Section 41.1 CRPC, the police officer is required to issue a notice directing the accused to appear before him as at a specified place and time. The officer and accused to appear before the police officer. Now, for violation of this, the court has sentenced the sub-inspector to 4 weeks imprisonment and also asked the state to take departmental action against that person. I would also like to mention here that recently the High Court of Bombay, before I go into that, next slide. I would just mention a rundown, because I think we have overshot the time. There are a number of rulings in by the Supreme Court for the protection of human rights on the issue of human rights. These are next. Yeah, this pertains to right to shelter, you know, Uttar Pradesh Avas Evam Vikas and Avas Evam Vikas versus Friends Cooperative Housing Society. This is 1996 judgment. And it says that we spring from the right to residence assured under Article 19(1)(e) and right to life under Article No Doctor Construction to be in accordance. That says that construction for the law laid down by the municipality, panchayat, or the state. But then you cannot deny, that cannot be a ground to refuse permission to construct and stay in a place. You have a right to shelter. Next. In Madhu Kishwar versus state of Bihar, it mentions about right to food. And here, the Supreme Court has also said that because right to food is something which is there in the directive principles, that is in the form of everybody has a right to adequate standard of living. So, and it says that here the Supreme Court has said that directive principles, though not enforceable by any court, are nevertheless fundamental in the governance of the country. Next, right to health has been also pronounced by the Supreme Court, and in state of Punjab versus Mohinder Singh Chawla, and right to equal pay for equal work in Ranveer versus Union of India. Next, right to life. Now, right to life is something which is very important, and I would just like to mention, after mentioning this particular Muralidhar Dayanand Keskar versus Vishwanath Pandu Bharde, in which the Supreme Court said that right to life under Article 21 comprehends its ambit. Now, right to life doesn't mean right to live, but it also says right to education, health, speedy trial, equal wages for equal work. That means every right. And I was mentioning, while mentioning about the right to privacy, what Justice D.Y. Chandrachud had mentioned, that that is right, that derives from right to life. Right to privacy is derived from right to every right, you can say, is derived from right to life. Next. See, in Olga Tellis versus Bombay Municipal Corporation, in fact, Supreme Court has said that the sweep of the right to life conferred by Article 21 is wide and far-reaching. Life means something more than mere animal existence. Next. And it says that And equally, that right to life may be one aspect of right to life, but then an equally important facet of that right is the right to livelihood, because no person can live without the means of livelihood. In fact, if your right to privacy is taken away, your right to life, you know, people may die, and people have died out of that also. So every aspect, the right to food, right to shelter, right to health, right to every aspect is related to right to life. This is what is mentioned in the right to next. Now, these are certain, of course, pertaining to the Supreme Court rulings against illegal arrest in Joginder Kumar versus State of Uttar Pradesh, then right to speedy trial and right to bail. There are different rulings in Husainara Khatun versus and others versus Home Secretary, State of Bihar, right to bail in Babu Singh versus State of Uttar Pradesh. Next. Very important is this pertains to State of West Bengal, right against custodial violence in D.K. Basu, who was a magistrate, you know, who was arbitrarily arrested as he felt, and the matter went up to Supreme Court, and Supreme Court came out with guidelines at that time on custodial violence, and followed by that, the National Human Rights Commission also has come out with guidelines and as to procedure that has to be followed, and that is also there in Article 20, as to, like, for example, he has a right to approach a lawyer, his relations have to be informed, the person who comes to arrest has to tell him for what offense he's been arrested, that person should be wearing a name badge, etc. And all these conditions were mentioned in the D.K. Basu versus State of West Bengal in 1997 by Supreme Court. Then right to legal aid, persons who can't afford lawyer, you know, they have a right to legal aid. That's how you have got the legal services everywhere in every state as well as at the national level. Next. So before I thank you, I would like to mention another this thing which just came out very recently. In fact, it's a recent judgment the right to life. I would like to mention is that there is a person by name Nirmala Kumari Uppu Ganti. Now this is a Bombay High Court ruling, and this lady, the petitioner, she is an under trial prisoner, and she has gone to the High Court under Article 226, and she is lodged at present in Baikula District Women Prison, Baikula in Mumbai, and she is suffering from the terminally ill due to cancer. Now NIA, National Investigating Agency, has already filed charge sheet against her on very serious offenses. If you see, against this accused and other co-accused under Article 302, 353, 120B, including your all other sections of, including 121A and your of UAPA and Explosive Substances Act, etc. So they're very serious offenses she's facing. But I would just like to mention what even then High Court had said, because she is terminally ill and she said that she needs to be shifted from the jail, because jail is not able to, you know, provide treatment or the facility which is required for her treatment. And she has made a petition of her treatment at Tata Memorial Hospital and facilitation of communications and meetings with Satyanarayan Rani, her husband, and co-accused, etc. The Supreme Court has said that the High Court of Bombay has said undoubtedly the petitioner is arraigned for grave offenses, yet in the peculiar facts of the case, especially having regard to the serious medical condition of the petitioner and the fact that he is terminally ill, absence of a provision of requisite palliative care and support would impinge on her right to life with dignity. It is right to life guaranteed to every person. 21 of the Constitution is a basic postulate of human rights. A prisoner, be he a convict or under trial or a detainee, does not cease to be a human being. Note these words, you know. Be he a convict or under trial or a detainee does not cease to be a human being. And even when lost in the jail, he is not deprived of his right to life guaranteed to him under Article 21 of the Constitution, which includes the right to obtain medical treatment. A prisoner cannot be deprived of health services as it would violate guarantee conferred under Article 21 of the Constitution. Having said that, the Supreme Court, the Honorable High Court of Bombay, has granted her the of being treated and kept in a separate hospital. So, to that extent, the right to life matters, and the right to life, the right to life has been said. These are the basic things which I wanted to tell about the human rights. I have gone more into the technical aspects of the human right than talking about the general scenario about violations which are happening. I have, while talking about the general scenario, I have mentioned about the various fundamental disturbing things which are at the international level as well as in the nation, which pertains to human rights violation. But I thought I should more in difference of university on the technical aspects of the human rights concern, so that you have an understanding of the human rights, and particularly with relation to our country, where the fundamental rights, the Constitution of India guarantees human rights in the fundamental rights, and also the nation and the government in enforcement of the economic, social, and cultural rights. So thank you very much. And if there are questions, I can take them. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for your observations and your reference being made to the polarized world and references being made to minority bashing. And the quintessential part of human rights and how human rights are inherent rights and how they are essentially related to our right to life, equality, liberty, and dignity. And you had also referred to how relevant are the rights in terms of creating obligations to protect, promote, and fulfill. And having said that, you had also referred to the provisions of the UDHR, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, and to the ICCPR and the ICSCPR, as well as to, in the Indian context, you have referred to the provisions of the Protection of the Human Rights Act, 1993. And you had actually referred to almost all the essential sections which embody human rights, including the Part 3 of the Constitution of India, as well as you have made passing references to the directive principles as well. To wind up, you had referred to some of the most important cases that intersect human rights jurisprudence, especially the cases of the case of D.K. Basu versus the State of West Bengal, adjudicated by the Supreme Court in the year 1997, and Hussein Ara Khatun's case, the Olga Tellis versus Bombay Municipal Corporation's case, and so on and so forth, many important cases. And you had also referred to the present very recent ruling of the Telangana High Court in reference to actually putting going against the sub-inspector of police and saying something that whatever you do, that even if you're in the role of a police officer, it must be, the procedure must be just, fair and reasonable. Having said this, I open this house for questions. I myself have a small question to ask, but I would request other distinguished academicians, research scholars, students of law and social sciences to come forward with questions, should they have anyone. You may either type the questions or you may ask to our honorable guest directly. Any of the faculty members? Any of the faculty members would like to ask any question to our honorable guest today?
Hello. Dr. Banerjee, this is Priyankar Ghosh, visiting faculty to SOLG.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Please go ahead with your questions, sir.
Good afternoon, sir. Dr. Rupak Kumar Datta, is nice and is a pleasing lecture to enlighten us on the human rights issue. I am a part of SLG as a faculty of the forensic science. And I understand that being a police officer, you must be also aware of the contribution made by the forensic science in the human rights issues. Now, that's also, I understand that you told around 40% cases are against mostly police departments. And I presume this is the same for all over India, in every state governments. Now, my only question here is that in the criminal justice system, there are three foundations. One is judiciary, one is the police, and one is the correctional homes. Now, human rights goes with which of these three institutions? They are more leaning towards the judiciary or to police or to correction homes? That is my only question, sir.
Very interesting question. When you ask, talk about human rights, each of these pillars of criminal justice system it relates. I would say it is relating to every, in fact, there is one more pillar, which is the prosecution. But then these three you have mentioned, I say that it relates to all the three. And you cannot say that it relates to one particular. Because, if police, in the police, what is police work? Police is the investigation work. In the investigation, there are violations, as I have mentioned some of them while in my lecture, then there is a violation of human rights. Similarly, even in judiciary, if there is a delay in trial, then this is a violation of human rights. And so, therefore, it even relates to judiciary. And the third is the correctional services. In fact, the correctional services, if you see, the violation of majorly happening, if it's any jail in your state, you would see as to, the pitiable condition. Number one is the jails are, the over staffed, and the number of prisoners which are kept are much more than or double the number of the space that is meant for. And number one, number two is that even in terms of the maintenance and all also, or medical care, the way the neglect is happening. So therefore, not only that, even in terms of behavior of the correctional staff. So the human rights violation is happening in every the arms by every arm of the criminal justice system, and it relates to every arm of the criminal justice system. Have I answered your question?
Thank you, sir.
Mohammed Ramiz Akhtar, a student from the School of Law and Justice, a student of the seventh semester would like to ask one question to our honorable guest. Please proceed, Mr. Ramiz.
Good afternoon, sir. Sir, actually, I am likely to enlighten the function of National Human Rights Commission or State Human Rights Commission. Recently, we have seen that there was massive post-poll violence in West Bengal. And after committing the incidents, after 3 or 4 months, the members of Human Rights Commission are going to the place, actually. So there is a heavier chance to turn the witness hostile. So how, sir, how the members of the Human Rights Commission are gathering evidences, how actually they work?
I would say, well, in an interesting question. See, I mean, I was not part of that the committee when a member of National Human Rights Commission had gone and they had examined. But when you say that the delay, you know, in a commission visiting, it need not be Human Rights Commission, any commission for that matter, or special commissions which are set up under the of Commissions Act. So the commissions, when they visit, they do visit with a delay. You know, so that's why one of the things is that it should be the commission should be set up immediately to go and visit. So yes, there is a chance that there can be, you know, the witnesses can turn hostile or witnesses can be won over. So in such cases, of course, the members of the commission, you know, as I said, members of the commission are either the members of judiciary or distinguished officers who have worked in the field of human rights, whether in the mostly from the civil services they come. So they have had long experience in such working. So they do know as to how to find out brain from the chaff, and they are able to discern the truth through examination of people, various people, and if they find that there is the kind of a people not coming out or people have turned hostile, they do mention that yes, there is some kind of a hostility which has come in, or that people are tutored and they are not coming out. Yeah, that does mention. But that problem is there. If there is a delay, such problem do happen. But then the members who come for visit and who come for examination of such people, they are quite aware of it, and they work on that to see that the truth is brought out. Thank you,
sir.
Anyone from the audience, from the learned audience, any students, research scholars, any of the faculty members would like to ask our honorable guest any question relating to human rights and their violations?
Sir, can you hear me?
Yes.
Am I audible, sir?
Yes, please proceed, Ms. Mack.
Very good afternoon, sir. I would like to know, sir, do you agree with the statement that human rights is a toothless tiger?
You are, I think you have hit the nail on the head. You can look at it that way also, in the sense that, as I was mentioning, that we do make recommendations. We do impose the saying that we can recommend prosecution, we can recommend payment of compensation, we can recommend for departmental action. And the law mentions that this has to be, you know, the government has to order that within a month. That is, the outer limit given is a month's time, that within a month the government has to enforce that. Or they must come out with as to why the recommendations of the Human Rights Commission is not acceptable. When it comes out with that and they send to us as to why the recommendation of the Human Rights Commission is not acceptable, we do again look into it. And if we insist on that, then the government should enforce that. And otherwise, the matter will go before the governor. So, that being the case, the law provides enough conditions as to how to see that it is not a toothless tiger. But then, in reality, you also use the word in reality. In reality, what is happening is the recommendations which are made by the Human Rights Commission, they are pending for months together. We also cannot you know, kind of drag them. We can go to court also. That but see, the governance again, you know, you have to wait. You have to give a chance. If they don't come out within a month, we do send reminder. We do remind them. We do summon them. We ask them. And by and large, they come out with, you know, it's not that we have had several recommendations where they have paid compensations, they have imposed departmental actions, departmental inquiry. That is happening. It's not exactly a toothless tiger, but then, yes, there is a chance of being a toothless tiger if the Human Rights Commission is not on its toes. You know, you have to be constantly chasing and I always say, you know, any enforcement agency for that matter can have an effect provided the persons who are the incumbents who are manning that enforcement agency, they are, you know, on their toes. I don't know the case of Karnataka Lokayukta at the point of time when Justice Santosh Hegde was there, Lokayukta, and I was part of the, you know, I was ADG in charge of the entire investigation of the Lokayukta. This was a nationally known Lokayukta at that time. And things were appearing everywhere. From every corner of the people were saying what Karnataka Lokayukta is doing. So it all depends on also the people who man. Otherwise, for that matter, any agency can be, you know, become a toothless institution. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. I believe there are no other questions in the chat box or any no other questions from the honorable faculty members, the research scholars and the students. Sir, I have, before we go to the vote of thanks to be given by none other than our honorable dean, I have two questions. So in this entire deliberation, we have possibly not focused on the right to property as a fundamental human right, which can actually elevate human positions. So it was there in the Constitution, but it was rooted out through the 44th Amendment. So do you think, this is one question, do you think that it has to be reinstated? And the second question I have is, many in this country, in this multilingual, multicultural country, many have been termed as non-state actors. So do you think that the non-state actors also have an essential role in peace building and in promoting human rights? So these are precisely my two questions for you. Thank you, sir.
Good question. When it comes to right to property, you also said that by 44th Amendment, it has been taken away. It was there in the right to freedom, one of the rights. And if you ask me, right to property, it has been taken away with, and it has been put in the ninth schedule. Why? So that, you know, you cannot challenge it also. Now, all this has been done with a purpose. Now, you know, ours was in the country in the making, and we had to construct dams, we had to construct roads, we had to construct industries. So acquisition of land was required for that purpose. And if this absolute right was granted, you know, right to property, perhaps it would have been an impediment in so far as, you know, social causes are concerned, or the development of the country is concerned. We would have faced problems there. But having said that, I would also say that yes, in some form, you know, it has to be there. Of course, right to property is there. You know, as such, nobody can take away our property without a particular procedure. I mean, that is what, you don't have absolute right to the property. There a procedure is there that under acquisition a notice is issued, and then under the, for a particular greater cause, and human being, and largely, you know, the society can exist when there is a survival of the maximum is there. You know, you cannot, for one per person, the majority cannot face problem. So therefore, it is seen that for the sake of the society as such, if a certain property has to be sacrificed, of course, not that he is not being given a compensation for that. He is paid a compensation for that. He is even given an alternate land for that. But then it is for the larger sake of the society as such, for the larger good that a particular needs to be taken, and therefore they have said, seen to it that this is not made an absolute right. And largely, if you see, you know, if property is something which affects whom? The people who are affluent, you know, the people who are mighty, you know, they are not affecting the many who are largely poor. So both ways you can see it from the angle of that it is for the good of the larger people. So therefore, this has been done with the purpose, and I see that right to property, if it has been taken away, it has been taken away rightly. And so far as the second point is concerned, that is non-state actors. Yes, that is a phenomena which has crept in now. That so far as non-state actors are concerned, this is the non-state actors. The problem is that these non-state actors are something which is from the back door. The state is acting. There is any non-state actor if the state is cautious and state is mindful. I always see to it that the non-state actors are coming up only because the state doesn't want to, when it doesn't want to come into the front, it brings out these non-state actors and work through them back door. So therefore, if the non-state actors are violating the human rights, I would also hold the state actors only responsible. So state has to ensure that the non-state actors, if they are cause for violation of human rights, the state is taken to task and state is held liable and responsible. Have I answered your question, Professor Banerjee?
Yes, sir. Thank you so much for your observations. We have two more questions, actually, one from Payodi and the other one from none other than our own faculty member, Mr. Shivam Pandey. And then after taking the questions, we will go for the winding up ceremony, which is a vote of thanks to be given by our Honorable Dean. So we proceed with the last two questions, please. So shall we proceed with the penultimate question?
Okay, please.
Good morning, sir. Can I start? Can I put my question?
Yes, please.
Yeah. So, sir, my question is that do you believe that human rights itself acts as a modus to discriminate sometimes, as in whom to choose and whom to provide the preference and whom not to, severally act as a subjective satisfaction of the institution severally? So do you think, sir, human rights itself acts as a modus to discriminate, and itself it is not colorblind?
Can you, Mr. Pandey, Shivam Pandey, can you elaborate, or can you just give an example as to why do you think that human rights itself discriminate?
Yes, sir. Sure, sir. Sir, previously what we used to see that there is equality or inequality between two people, so we can actually comment that this is unequal or this is not equal. But if there are situations like a person is behind incarceration, like he's in jail, there are certain situations in which police and different machineries or functionaries acts as a modus to provide justice or not to provide justice. So they do play a very vital role as a modus. So in that situation, don't you think that it's a new kind of discrimination, that whether we will be providing justice or not, it is not only upon the justice delivery system, but the machineries from which it is going to the subjects?
If I have understood you, what you are going to say is the whether the machinery itself they are kind of discriminating when it comes to the observation of human rights. Is that what you are wanting to say, Mr. Pandey? That be so, if the machinery, for example, you spoke about police, well, so far as violation of human rights are concerned, concerned by these, are all known things, you know, I mean, let's not talk about it. But when it comes to equality, inequality, you said that there were two concepts. So now, if somebody is coming to give a complaint, you know, of his rights being violated before an institution, say police, and the police is supposed to act as per law, and the law is laid down, law is well written, you know, quoted law, and the procedure is also well laid. So if it is followed, there is no question of what is called action when it comes to enforcing law. I can say that,
hello. Yeah, I believe there is some issue with with our honorable guest's mic. Sir, are you sir? Am I audible?
Connect. When it comes to Article 15, it is
yeah, can the host confirm whether our honorable guest is still there? Can any of the hosts confirm whether the honorable guest is still there?
Yes, sir. He is here, sir.
Okay.
Have I answered? I think you have. It's again and again disconnecting. So I don't know whether you have been able to hear what I said.
Well, I believe, sir, we could. I believe we could not hear you because of some network issues. Hello. Sir, are you there online? Would any of the hosts confirm, please? Whether Sri Datta is there? Can any of the hosts confirm, please, whether Sri Datta is there? Okay, thanks. Okay. Thank you, Alam sir, for letting us know that he's getting disconnected again and again. So let us wait for another 2-3 minutes and then we will proceed with the vote of thanks. You give him a call, no?
There has been this thing. So, do we wind up now?
Yes, sir. Actually, we will wind it up with the concluding remarks and the vote of thanks of none other than our Honorable Dean, Professor Dr. Kamaraju Chitrapu. And he will wind up this session, this vote of thanks. Over to you, sir.
Good afternoon, all of you. Thank you very much. At the outset, I'm very much thankful to the speaker of the day, Mr. Rupak Kumar Datta, for his valuable and as well as enriching and empowering as well as enlightening interface with all our students of UG and PG. And before that, I would like to say not more than one or two minutes about the initiatives taken by our Honorable Chancellor Sir to avail this hybrid mode of learning, evolving and encapsulating all 21st century teaching skills and facilitating as a role model. And under his able leadership, our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Pro Vice Chancellors, Deans, HODs, faculties, everybody at the Adamas University, while it was started in the year 1985 as a off-branch of the Rice Group University. Now in 2015, it became the university, and our law school has also started its journey in the year 2015, and two batches have gone, and it is a pride, privilege, and honored and humbled with your presence, sir, and we are very helpful to all of you to join this, sparing this time. And I appreciate your initiatives. And on behalf of our law school, I am very happy if at all you come to this part of our country, please do visit our campus and enlighten with your presence, because many of the journalism students as well as the School of the political science, and all people came and joined with keen interest, because we have multiple backings that belongs to West Bengal as well as to this part of our country. And we would like to have, if any possibility is there, any internship studies, any internship opportunities to do for 1 month as part of Honorable Supreme Court of India and Bar Council of India regulations. If we can able to satisfy the people, will get very much happy. And also any research related assignments, we're very much keen, sir. And I'm very, very thankful for all of you who spare their valuable time and interest, enthusiasm, despite many other commitments. I'm very much thankful to Rupak Kumar Datta, sir. And also because you were introduced by none other than your chairman, Justice Shetty, sir. And I'm very thankful. Also, I spoke to him. And he says that I will wish you all success for this program. Like that he conveyed, I'm very much thankful to you, sir. And now we are signing out of this program. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all. Thank you.